Hi, this presentation is going to go over the epidemiological transition, sort of a historical, theoretical understanding of mortality changes over time, and we're going to look at some of the global mortality patterns as an illustration of that. So the epidemiological transition is an attempt to explain the stages that countries go through with regard to leading causes of mortality. In the first stage, what we see is widespread naturally occurring diseases and pandemics. In Europe, for instance, we saw this in the 1300s when the Black Plague was rampant. That continued for several centuries beyond that. By the second stage, we begin to see widespread improvements in terms of medicine, sanitation, and diet. For the developed world, that began in the 1850s. For other parts of the world, it has not really happened yet, particularly in Central and Eastern and Western Africa. In the third stage, the leading causes of death become widespread degenerative or human-induced diseases. And in some respects, only those countries where people live long enough to develop such problems as heart disease and cancers will they become the leading causes of death. If people are dying in their 40s and 50s, they're not living long enough to develop those degenerative diseases. So, of course, reaching third stage is going to coincide with an expanding life expectancy. So transitions in less industrialized countries are occurring later compared to the Western world, but also that's occurring faster because history has sped up. Those countries can benefit from the experience of the West. For example, if we look at the incidence of tuberculosis, we can see that the lowest incidence are in some of the most wealthy parts of the world, West Europe, Northern and Western Europe, Australia, New Zealand, North America. If we look at middle income, we see moderate incident rates. And if we look at the poorest parts of the world, in Africa and Southeast Asia, we begin to see some of the highest rates of tuberculosis. So that is indicative of being at an earlier stage in the epidemiological transition. And perhaps one of the most striking illustrations of mortality patterns is looking at life expectancy, how long people can expect to live on average at birth. And in this map, you see the greener colors, people are living longer, and the sort of orange reddish colors, people are living much shorter lives. And you can see there's a strong geographic concentration of the lower life expectancies in middle and southern Africa. Northern Africa is different. It's more of a Middle Eastern and oil-producing region. The longest life expectancies, as you see, are Oceania, North America, and Europe primarily, and moderate to high in Latin America and parts of Asia, and then sort of the lower moderate are include Russia and India and some of the other Asian, Southeast Asian nations. So if we're going to try to assess the overall evidence for the epidemiological transition, we could probably conclude that it's somewhat mixed or only kind of weakly supported. Wealthy countries are exactly where the theory would expect in terms of being in the last stage and so forth, but the less developed countries of the world are in varying places, and it really is not explained well by the epidemiological transition, which is a little too sweeping and broad in its predictions, and that there are several country-specific dynamics that are leading to this variability and nuance. So at the end of the day, mortality is something that's much more complicated than the overall framework of the epidemiological transition, but it still provides a good general rule of thumb, with the understanding that it's certainly not deterministic or highly predictive, particularly at lower stages of development. That's going to wrap up our discussion. Thanks for watching.